This is the Wood Innovation Research Lab at the University of Northern British Columbia. It's a center for world-class research on wood mechanics and timber structures. Known as WIRL, this mass timber structure was built in 2018 to the stringent passive house energy standard, setting a Canadian record for air tightness. And in 2023, this building faced a test that none of its designers could ever have imagined.
At precisely 7:01 this morning, an explosion so intense it blew windows out in neighboring businesses, wiped out the former Achillean restaurant at the corner of 4th and Dominion. It was a building that had been vacant for more than 10 years.
I was driving in, I got a call from one of the technicians and saying there was an explosion, there's fire.
The main and first foremost concern was about the safety of our students and lab technicians. And fortunately, nobody was in the lab at the moment of the explosion, so that was the first relief. And then over the next hours, my main concern was how would this impact our research.
And while no one from UNBC was hurt, there were three people injured.
Your building was the closest exposure to that event. Once it was all said and done, there was numerous buildings in quite an area that were identified as exposures, but your building was certainly one of the most impacted from our perspective.
The worst fear would be that the whole building with all its contents would burn down and we wouldn't have a lab for quite a while.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty rare that you get to see a building you've designed go through something as extreme as an explosion right next door. Honestly, first impressions are that the building performed really, really well. There's some obvious damage, mostly due to the fire and the subsequent firefighting efforts. But overall, the building performed better than I think anybody could have predicted or expected based on the severity of the event that had occurred.
And talking to the fire department afterwards, when they let us back in after a couple of days of checking air values and everything, it was actually interesting to hear their stance on it too, that they said that most other buildings, if it had been constructed like anything else around downtown, it might have come down to a complete loss. So the building by itself and in itself helped sort of itself in a sense to survive.
The natural gas explosion shook the building, much like an earthquake. It also drove debris through this cladding, which allowed fire to enter the wall. As it burned through the wall, the sprinkler system engaged, put the fire out, but it also flooded the building. So in the space of a couple hours, this building experienced the equivalent of an earthquake, fire, and a flood.
I think these events are exceptionally rare. This is the first one I've ever experienced. So it's a learning experience for me to sort of get acquainted with what damage can happen and how to reconstruct it.
Yeah, so the explosion creates a massive pressure wave. The closest analogy would be wind loads on a building, so it's pushing and sometimes pulling on the exterior of the building.
The shockwave was substantial. The anchors on the wall that actually was on fire, so the wall had moved outward by about 2 inches.
We could see from the base of the panels pushed inwards to the building and then they were sucked back out again, and there was some permanent deformation there. So it overloaded some of the brackets anchoring the panels to the foundation. But that's pretty much it. Everything appears to have bounced back. Everything is plumb, level, appears to be more or less fully intact beyond just the immediate affected area here behind us. You don't need to do it on the end bay. This one's pretty much intact still. But this bay and the next bay, maybe it's going to be these three, and probably at like the 1/3, 2/3 height mark. But I mean, this is all going to be compromised anyways.
Yeah, it's coming off.
So, why was WIRL so resilient, and what were the factors that limited the impacts?
But the two primary pieces of the building that really helped with that is one is the use of floor joists within the wood panels has an incredible durability and strength that could withstand the blast.
So there's not a lot of wood there, there's a lot of air there, and that gap is filled with insulation, which is essentially a rock wool, it's ground up rock, and it doesn't burn.
So that also was a barrier for that fire to be prevented from moving into the structure of the building.
As the firefighters extinguished the fire, that same insulation got wet. This building is designed with multiple membranes that allow water vapor to migrate through them, so that if that wall gets wet, it can dry itself out. What we found when we went to do the reconstruction is that's exactly what it did.
It's got an amazingly airtight and watertight envelope. You can see actually, like, despite where some places burned through, the rest of the membrane is intact. Well, I think it's interesting, as a passive house, these wall panels were appended to the outside of the building. They're, typically we'd have load-bearing walls, so there's an interior gravity post and beam structure that holds up all the weight from snow and loads like that. And the walls were outside of that, so they were self-supporting, which makes them secondary to the building structure, so damage to the wall panel doesn't result in overall damage to the building, and it can be replaced and remediated.
Passive house is relatively new to Canada, so we do not have a lot of examples of how to reconstruct or renovate them. Turns out, the way you fix a passive house is the same way you built it in the first place. Peel it back to expose a membrane and go from there.
Using prefabrication means that we have shop drawings on file from when these panels were originally produced. They can go into production tomorrow and we can start the remediation efforts right away. So I think the ability to bring it back into service in a really time and cost-effective manner, I think that's going to be one of the successes of building this way.
So having prefabricated buildings not only enhances the speed of construction for the initial building, but it also allows for individual components to be replaced somewhat easier, because all wall panels are sort of almost like a catalog item. You can just go, and we essentially did, ask Vinton Homes, we need two of panel A, two of panel B, and one panel C. They manufacture those panels, they don't have to come to site, measure anything. They just made these panels exactly the same, and it was a one-to-one replacement. Once they showed up here on site, broken panel A comes out, new panel A goes in, and it fits like a glove.
From its inception, the Wood Innovation Research Laboratory has been both a lab where UNBC researchers conduct leading-edge experiments, as well as a model structure in its own right.
The Wood Innovation Research Lab is known worldwide and very well respected, so it has put us on the map. We have such a unique lab that most of what we do cannot be reproduced anywhere else.
We have been proven this through the events as well, because there was a lot of other labs that were actually offering to help with some of the testing, ended up not working out because they don't have all the facilities that we have.
So in this building, we have state-of-the-art timber manufacturing and timber testing equipment. And what we're doing here is really provide guidance to engineers and designers on how to safely and efficiently design with novel connectors and novel structural materials that are not necessarily yet in the standard.
We're all sorry about what happened and the people that got injured and the property that was lost, but since it is there, it's going to be used to showcase the effectiveness of wood as a building material.
Investment in passive house for post-secondary clients is still in its infancy. So UNBC is very progressive and ahead of the curve when it comes to the investment in their facilities.
UNBC chose to invest in passive house buildings because the energy efficiency furthers our aims of sustainability, while also delivering an unsurpassed level of occupant comfort.
And what we've learned is that that value that was added for its thermal performance sustainability also provides value for its resiliency. So as we move into this climate change and increased in traumatic fire events, there is some lessons to be learned about how this type of construction adds value not only in economics and sustainability, but also in resiliency.
Good engineering always goes beyond what the standard requires you to do, and current design standards, for instance, do not require you to consider collapse prevention. However, the building, the way it was designed, actually did withstand a blast right next door without any single element collapsing. So that's really a sign of good engineering.
In the end, I think everyone has been convinced that the building has performed beyond anyone's expectations in general, and that has been a very reassuring fact for us.
We can apply what we've learned in this building to other buildings by making smart decisions from the onset of design.
Good design protects you in ways that you can't necessarily predict you'll need to be protected.
The events of August 2023 illustrate the value of mass timber design. WIRL's resiliency will allow researchers to continue their work to inform the next generation of safe, modern, energy-efficient mass timber construction.